Heinemann Publishing presents The Artful Read-Aloud, 10 Principles to Inspire, Engage, and Transform Learning. Written and narrated by me, Rebecca Bellingham. Published by Heinemann Publishing. To Annabelle and Ezra, raising and reading to you are the joys of my life. I hope you discover the world and yourselves in the books that will light your way. I love you to the moon, the stars, and the galaxies beyond and back. Introduction. You need intelligence and you need to look. You need a gaze, a wide gaze, penetrating and roving. That's what's useful for art. Toni Morrison. Toni Morrison's description of what's useful for art, intelligence, a penetrating and wide gaze, and a desire and capacity for looking and noticing, is a beautiful summation of what I find useful for reading aloud to children. Without fail, every time I've shined a spotlight on the importance of reading aloud and the artful instructional moves inside an effective interactive read aloud, teachers and graduate students have told me how much it affected them, how they changed their practice, or how they made room for reading aloud in their classrooms. They often tell me it completely shifts the dynamics of their classrooms, that children's passion for books and stories skyrockets, their conversations about characters and stories lead to more inclusive, thoughtful communities, and kids read their own independent books with more vigor and commitment. Several years ago, one of my graduate students in the Literacy Specialist program at Teachers College said to me, "You should just become the queen of read aloud." Of course, I laughed at this idea, and also sort of enjoyed the idea of being the queen of something, but it planted a seed. I should write a book about everything I had learned about reading aloud from the stance of both an educator and an artist. I should write a book that would make it possible for teachers to give children one of the most important gifts an educator can give, access to the power and wonder of story. I started my career as a teaching artist in New York City, working with the Dream Yard Project, a community arts organization that places artists in long-term residencies in public schools. At the time, I was also a working actress. In between auditions, rehearsals, and sometimes 8 shows a week, I integrated theater and music into multiple curricular areas in several schools across the South Bronx. I directed plays, musicals, choirs, and Shakespearean performances. I helped develop original plays and performances using the stories, poems, and ideas of children in kindergarten through 8th grade. For most of these children, my fellow teaching artists and I were the art departments in their schools. Most of the time, they didn't have school-based music or drama classes, and they certainly didn't have budgets for annual shows where kids could perform on stage and experience the singular magic of putting on a show together. My cadre of teaching artists, classroom teachers, and I produced many works of art on a shoestring budget. We didn't have spotlights or fancy costumes. We had the simplest of tools: our voices, our bodies, our understanding of color and space, our imaginations, and our ability to make something beautiful simply by singing, speaking, and moving as an ensemble. And we had words from books, plays, and the students themselves. We had words that felt thrilling or hilarious. We had words that told stories of great courage or great treachery and that taught us how to help one another in times of need. Most importantly, we had the glorious imaginations and open hearts of the children with whom we worked. The combination of those words and the children's joyful capacity for expressing them made it possible to make magic. What we had were things every teacher has access to. We had great stories to tell and groups of children eager to hear those stories and bring them to life. After many years of working as a teaching artist and eventually a classroom teacher, literacy coach, and instructor, I started thinking more and more about how to help teachers use the tools artists have long used to spark engagement, connect deeply, provoke inquiry, and inspire deep thinking. And I began with a time of day that has always been my favorite as a classroom teacher, literacy coach, graduate-level instructor, and mom: the read aloud. While most teachers do daily read alouds and believe in their importance, there are moves we can make to significantly elevate the instructional power of reading aloud. For instance, making small shifts with our bodies and voices can help kids envision different characters and their actions more completely. Slowing down, creating silences, and being aware of pacing can help kids begin to understand that certain passages hold key information and are worth rereading and lingering over. Making intentional eye contact with students during pivotal scenes between characters helps students infer the emotions, consider the significance of moments across the book, or simply feel utterly drawn into the story. Each of these moves is also artistic in nature. Embodiment, breath, and connection are at the center of almost every artistic endeavor, and they can make a read-aloud instructional and beautiful and compelling at the same time. There are several wonderful books already in the field about the importance of reading aloud by literacy greats, such as Jim Trelease, Lester Laminack, and Mem Fox. Those books leave no doubt about the importance of reading aloud and demonstrate the instructional moves teachers can make in order to teach real reading inside one. This book is a deeper dive into the artistry of reading aloud. It is a user-friendly guide that builds a bridge between the artistic world and the teacher's classroom. It's a rich exploration of the way in which teaching in general, and specifically the interactive read aloud, is as full of artistic and creative potential as any other great work of art. How to listen to this book. When I set about writing this book, I thought about the guiding principles that have informed my approach to reading aloud to children in classrooms, as well as the instructional, listening, and engaging moves I make. Ultimately, I chose 10. These principles guide my work as a teacher and an artist in general, and have been inspired by many years of working in all kinds of classrooms, theaters, arts-based spaces, and learning environments. Each chapter focuses on a specific guiding principle that can deepen the impact of our interactive read-alouds. And within each chapter, there are also several specific tips for incorporating the principle into your daily work with children. These concrete tips are a way of breaking down a more abstract principle so that you can try things on immediately and successfully. While the order of these principles is intentional, you may decide not to listen to this book in a linear fashion. There is no exact order to thinking about these principles, so feel free to listen out of order should certain ideas catch your attention first. Rather than listening to the whole book at once, you may end up dipping into one or two chapters at a time and focusing specifically on only a few principles, threading those new understandings and tips into your work. There will no doubt be some ideas that may feel a little uncomfortable at first, but I am sending you courage in advance for trying on a new stance and embracing a willingness to slow down and make space for words to come alive. While these 10 principles are certainly specific to the read aloud, they extend beyond that part of the day. I hope that you learn actionable strategies and ideas for creating real moments of artistry during read aloud, but also that you consider applying these principles to other times of your day or other components of your curriculum. As you listen, I hope you continue to tap into your own innate artistic impulses. Approach your daily read-alouds with even more imagination, curiosity, and vision, and begin to listen or look a little differently than before. Sometimes when I read professional books, I finish reading and begin overhauling and deconstructing everything about my choices in teaching life. Rest assured, this book will not send you down that rabbit hole. This is a guide to creating greater engagement, joy, connection, and beauty in your teaching life overall. Chapter 1, Why Read Aloud Matters, Raising a Culture of Readers. When I say that reading aloud will change the world, I know it sounds simple. But one of the many great things about giving kids access to the power of stories and sharing them together is that it is simple. It is also cheap and easily done. And the impact is huge. Pam Allen. Reading aloud to children every single day is one of the most important things any teacher can do to help children grow and become better readers, better thinkers, and frankly, better human beings. The more I read to children in classrooms and to teachers and graduate students with whom I work, the more convinced I am that it is one of the most powerful tools we have to raise kids, teach kids, and create compassionate and civil communities. Scores of researchers and literacy advocates agree with me. A 2018 International Literacy Association leadership brief states, "Reading aloud is undoubtedly one of the most important instructional activities to help children develop the fundamental skills and knowledge needed to become readers. Reading aloud was also called the single most important activity for building the knowledge required for eventual."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.